please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Or can we improve governance even under the current structure? Last week, we got an answer from an unexpected source. Vinod Rai, chairman of the Bank Boards Bureau. In a 50-page letter to the government, Mr. Rai argues that it is possible to improve governance and that his bureau had put forth many plans on board composition, compensation of bankers, code of conduct, business strategy, and the works, but the Department of Financial Services has not even responded to a bunch of their suggestions. Today, I have with me two people who are eminently placed to discuss the BBB's complaints to check whether they are justified and if the Bureau can be used as a tool to improve governance. I have with me Mr. S.S. Mundra, former Deputy Governor of the Reserve Bank of India and himself a commercial banker until recently, and Mr. Ashwin Parekh, Managing Partner at Ashwin Parekh Advisory Services, 30 years in advising banking. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. Mr. Mundra, let me start. It's only a 50-page report, so I assume all of you have gone through the contents. My primary question is that Mr. Rai says, I have made these recommendations. I am awaiting reply from the DFS. Have we made a mistake in the way the Bureau is designed? Is it too toothless, too powerless?
Okay. Lata, if you, I think let's spend some time going back to the beginning. Mm. This all started with the FM speech in the budget speech. Mm. And there, if you look at it, the wordings were used that the Bureau would be entrusted with, you know, appointment, search and select head of the public sector banks.
Yes.
And help them in develop the differentiated strategy. Mm. But there was a very important sentence in that pronouncement that this would be an interim step. This would be an interim step which would, move towards the establishing a bank holding and investment company.
Yes, absolutely.
And thereafter, government came out with the notification. Mm. And notification was again, you know, mentioning only about the appointment of full-time directors and engaging with the bank boards for the strategies and the capital raising. Mm. At least if I look at the budget speech and this particular, you know, gazette notification, it was really not going beyond that. Mm. Having said that, thereafter, the Bureau in the initial phase of, when it was being set up, I think it was from the preliminary discussion, a viewpoint emerged that they should set up their own, framework in which they will operate.
Yeah.
And as mentioned in Mr. Rai's letter, they sent a whole list. Mm. But again, I see that four crucial points from that were again excluded. That is the appointment of, non-old-time directors. The stressed asset
regulation,
moving towards the holding company, right. Yeah. So these were the points which were, and there was one recommendation that once they finalize the candidate, it should go directly to the appointment committee of the cabinet, which was also not accepted. Mm. So I think from the very beginning, the framework was really carrying a very less mandate. Mm. Having said that, some of these are integral part. When you say you engage with the bank board or prepare the strategies or do the capital planning, obviously these things cannot happen until and unless you engage with the majority owner or the provider of the capital.
Yes.
So in an indirect way, this was providing a framework to engage with the government.
Yep.
So I would put it like this. Strictly in the given framework, I think the mandate was very limited and it was for the Bureau to take a decision in the beginning itself whether they would like to operate within that mandate or not.
Yes.
That's the point one.
Yeah.
But since within that mandate also there was a room for engagement, I think it would have been fair for them that if they are making a recommendations which are meaningful, I think they should have got a response to that.
Okay. Yeah, I take your point that the crucial things they were asking, that their recommendations go directly to the appointments committee, that they be allowed to even put the roadmap to holding company and appoint non-executive members. These important things were not given to them at all. Let me ask you that, Mr. Parekh. Do you think this board is by design wrong? It should be someone probably who is already in government, who has the mandate. Such an advisory body was always designed to flop.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, basically, there are two parts to it. I mean, can we say that it had to stop just as being an advisory body, for example? If it is just an advisory body, then once again, as Mr. Mundra said, the matters will have to go back to the shareholder, the majority shareholder, in which case the majority shareholder decides. I thought, therefore, giving more powers or more, let's say, a larger mandate to this body was very essential. So that was the first point. The second point was perhaps, and of course, it's easy for me to say this, but let's say BBB, should have really looked at the original report, Dr. P.J. Nair committee report, which it is, once again, putting out in the compendium. And they should have really looked at the mandate, and they should have at least pointed out the gaps in the mandate. For example, let's say to suggest that these are the areas where, unless the government engages and unless I get decisions, it's difficult for BBB.
Absolutely.
So I would have rather that instead of, let's say, this being a compendium, if it was an action taken report on the side of all the stakeholders.
Okay.
And say, look, this is the action the stakeholders have taken. It would give the nation a clear understanding, of
that this is the gap between.
There's a gap between the, exactly, and who's
what
supposed
Dr.
to do
Nayak
what.
Suggested. In a way, I think Mr. Rai is mentioning that when he mentions the same four points that Mr. Mundra mentions. I want this power, you didn't give it to me. So he has, in a sense, shown the gap. But Mr. Mundra, a more fundamental question, therefore, is this an not the way to go ahead at all? Do we just have to recognize that owner controls, therefore change ownership? We have no hope for reform unless ownership is brought below 51%, or below 50%. Is that a fair point to take?
No, Lata. I think I don't agree with that. At some point of time, that may be the road and that may be the ultimate destination. But given the environment, circumstances, and various other factors where we are operating today, I don't think it is something which would be desirable to happen in the short run. And I have spoken on this.
Yes.
The point actually, what I believe actually, that there are ways where the separation of ownership and management can still be achieved.
Okay.
And it is not something which is not happening. There are several examples in the globe where this is happening.
Okay.
And I think from that perspective, that concept of bank holding company was something which should have been pursued. And this is what was mentioned by the finance minister in the original speech also, where the concept of bank board bureau was first introduced.
Yes.
So I think that should be the roadmap. And then, as I did mention, in the first step, you have the bank holding company, which is majority holding, having the majority holding in the banks, and government is having the majority holding in the holding company.
Yes.
In the second step, bank holding company may not have the majority holding in individual banks, while the government continue to have majority holding in the holding company.
Yes.
And in the third stage, at both the levels, the majority holding is removed.
Absolutely.
I think that could be a roadmap.
Okay.
This roadmap may take some time. I think it will have advantages of both the situation, and it will pave the way which can be implementable, considering all the ground realities, the political sensitivities.
Okay.
I think that should be the roadmap.
Okay. Now, actually, I take your point completely. Incidentally, Mr. Mundra, you are in very elevated company. Several guests in our previous editions agreed with what you said, saying that you don't necessarily have to go under 50% for everything. I mean, Dr. Jalan said that in a mild way, even Raghuram Rajan said that. But we didn't discuss the holding company in such detail. What would your thoughts be? There are an equal number of people who believe that all this is halfway house.
Yeah.
Just bring down the stake. That is the only way to change. Otherwise, owner calls the shots.
Well,
what would you
say? I don't think that is a real issue. I mean, if you really asked me, the acceptance of the fact, let's say that the ownership and the management can be separate or can be separated, you know, is the first acceptance. Mm. Now, time and again, I mean, we've seen, for instance, let's say that if, let's say the government in many cases may have reduced its holding to 52%, 53%, yet when it comes to making major decisions, do we really go about the whole thing like the way any listed entity is going about it? We don't take special resolutions.
No, 52 is, I was arguing for under 50, and many people have argued that the only way this thing changes is bring it below 50.
But anything more than 26%, you know, technically, still puts the government or the shareholder at a point where they can really do what they please to do.
So therefore, handle governance ownership is not adequate.
That's one part. The second part, I think somewhere along we are all missing out on an important point. Ownership is associated with a certain order of liability and responsibility. Mm. If the government wants to keep 51%, there's nothing wrong. I mean, politically, if the environment is not conducive, and if you cannot bring it down to anything less than 51%, then at least accept the fact that there is a larger responsibility of restoring capital. Mm. Let's say, and the capital must be brought in proper form, you know, then in that case. So continuous responsibility.
Okay, I take both your points on board that, you know, we have to, at the moment, fix governance and governance can be fixed and ownership can be attended to at a later date in the roadmap in which Mr. Mundra is putting it. I have to take a break, but I want to try and discuss whether under the current circumstances, some of the suggestions of Mr. Rai can still be implemented. We are back in a minute. PSB 2.0, Reinventing Public Sector Banks. I have been speaking with Mr. S.S. Mundra, the former Deputy Governor of the Reserve Bank of India, himself formerly a chairman of a bank, and Mr. Ashwin Parekh, a long-time and expert in banking issues. Well, Mr. Mundra, before the break, you were saying that, you know, you can fix governance even with 51% ownership. Now, the reality is I don't see the government changing the BBB to a holding company anytime soon. It doesn't look like it is politically on the table. Which of Mr. Rai's suggestions do you think can still make a very big difference? I mean, we could start with his compensation or his, you know, the composition of the board itself. Do you think some of these can be immediately put into practice?
No, but that is why I was mentioning not changing the fundamental issue of you know, structure of control and expecting that these various, you know, things can be implemented. To my mind, it would be a difficult call. I think the very first requirement is the composition of the board of directors. And if the board of directors can will continue to remain in the way as they are today, and to expect that there would be a great deliverance of corporate governance, there would be a great infusion of the specialization of the insight, I think that will be, to put it very mildly, that will be expecting too much. And that is why, you know, if there is a complete separation as far as the individual banks are concerned, their individual working is concerned, and that can all be handled at the level of holding company, whereas while as the holding company level, government can have the, you know, the control and the larger mandate.
Mr. Mundra, your
which can operate from there.
You are very
my
nicely
mind,
saying
that will be the only.
Yeah, you are nicely saying that this experiment is not going to succeed. So there is no point even trying to make this kind of a BBB work.
No. What I'm trying to say, Lata, that, you know, what is put in that document is a long wish list. There are many things. All the suggestions are very excellent. But if you look at those, most of those suggestions are what is already, you know, in existence for the other organization, either under the Companies Act 2013 or the LODR of SEBI 2015. All those things are there. And he himself has mentioned that precisely these points have been raised from time to time. When they have not happened till now, I really find it difficult to believe that suddenly how all of them will again, you know, become operational. That is my point.
Okay. Bob, what's your sense, Mr. Parekh? This government has another 13, 15 months before it has to renew its work permit, as it were. Can any of this actually happen? Or, you know, do we just have to allow the situation to just meander in dereliction?
Well, actually, it can happen. I mean, if you go back to the report itself, for instance, there's a very interesting observation that has been made. They say that in the normal course, from good governance principle, it's important to recognize that nominee directors are not independent directors.
Absolutely.
You see, I mean, that's the first important point. So leave aside the format.
But that will not change because the Banking Undertaking Act is not going to change.
No, so therefore, if the government were to agree, you know, that the composition of the board has to have independent directors, and the independent directors must be chosen independent of the shareholders' requirements or wishes. You know, for instance, the minute I suppose that acceptance is there, you know, then I suppose you can really go forward. So it's just a matter of saying that nominee directors, so when you compose, let's say when you constitute the board,
nominee directors will qualify, you will only pick those who qualify as independent directors under the Companies Act.
Then that case they are not picked up by the government, it has to be picked up by an independent body, which is what the report is actually talking about.
Which is what the BBB ought to be.
Ought to be, exactly.
Mr. Mundra, would you say that will work? That even if the government were to only accept that the BBB picks all the directors, those two things which they refuse, allowing them to pick non-exec and sending it directly to the Appointments Committee, will that make a difference?
Yeah, that will make a difference, but that exactly is the point I am telling, that that was their first, you know, at the initial stages of their formation, that exactly was the request which was made and which was not acceded to. So it's a, you know, if it can happen, is really serving all the requirement, that while you are living within the framework of today's legislation, but at the same time you are achieving the purpose of having the independent director kind of thing. And you know, having this director, independent director and the board, then this itself is not sufficient. Okay. Then you have to go by some other framework which is already in Companies Act or in the listing obligation, that most of the crucial committees should be headed by these independent directors.
True.
Independent directors should meet at least once in the year independently, evaluate the board and the key management personnel. You know, those are the kind of things which should also follow.
Okay.
The point I was trying to make, that at this point of time, immediately I see little possibilities of all of those being
happening,
translated into action.
Okay.
A recommendation per se, no one can have any dispute about that.
Okay.
Everything on the ethics, governance, compensation, reward system, appraisal, everything is fine.
Yes.
The point is implementation.
Okay. No, I
that was the that was the point I was trying to make.
There is another related suggestion which came from a lot of the previous speakers, Dr. Jalan, Monte Kaluwalya, Vagul. Vagul was quoting the Narasimham Committee as giving this suggestion. Just abolish the banking, the Department of Financial Services.
True.
Is that the way, the point to begin, Mr. Parekh?
I think that's a good point. I mean, quite honestly, that recommendation, I see a lot of merit in that. If you look at, once again, let's say if you look at the constitution or the composition, see, till about 2007-2008, the Ministry of Finance or the shareholder was conspicuous by his absence.
Okay.
You know, from the boards or from the active managing of the banking system, basically.
Okay.
You know, and therefore, the boards could decide, the banking system
really?
Could. I mean, not to a large extent, but at least the amount of, let's say, the influence or the intervention that you have after 2008, suddenly it grew much more. So, I mean, I certainly agree with that, that if you just remove that department, for instance, you know, that's one. Second is, I think I see what Mr. Mundra is saying, and a very valid point. If you bring, let's say, the Nationalized Banking Act at par with the Companies Act, then automatically governance issues are
yes,
are
sir,
solved.
This is the oldest suggestion.
Yeah.
Why we already made it in 2002.
Yeah.
I mean, Dr. Nayak makes it again in 2013, and now Vinod Rai is making it again in 2018. We are only talking to each other, nobody is listening. Mr. Mundra, last point to you. Even under the circumstances, if the Department of Financial Services is taken off, do things change at all?
See, let's look like this. From the time those committee recommendations which are mentioned, from that time to till now, a huge developmental agenda has come into the, you know, being. It has come into the existence.
Which is?
And one thing, let us all be clear, that a part of this developmental agenda is very crucial for the country, for the variety of the regions and for the larger good of the society. We have to have an inclusive banking system.
Okay.
So, you know, forget about the glitches in implementation, but I am not sure that we can completely give up this developmental agenda. I am also not very sure that until and unless there is a structured way of steering it, it would be carried forward by the individual players on their own. That's not a very strong possibility. So what I am trying to say, while I really don't see much meaning of DFS existing as a separate department, but their going away would certainly create a vacuum, and this vacuum has to be filled in. And I think that is where this mandate can very well pass on to Bank Board Bureau, and they can continue to implement this mandate. I think that would be something which I would advocate for.
Okay, sir, we have run out of time, but I think we are ending the conversation with some very important suggestions. One, that unless you have this Bank Board Bureau getting to a holding company, we don't have much hope. Replacing the Banking Undertakings Act with the Companies Act is something, a path which we need to follow. This is all even without the government stake falling. And thirdly, an important suggestion, don't have the Department of Financial Services, replace it with the Bank Board Bureau, a highly empowered Bank Board Bureau. Even that might perhaps salvage the situation. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Mundra and Mr. Parikh, for joining me in this conversation.
आपका जो एक कमिटमेंट था कि दिल्ली से मेरठ 45 मिनट में पहुंच जाया जाएगा, ये बताइए कि हम अभी कितनी दूर हैं?
8 या 10 तारीख को प्रधानमंत्री के हाथ से उसका इनॉग्रेशन करने जा रहा है।
10 तारीख को, 10th ऑफ ये अभी।
Yes.
लेकिन चंद्रबाबू नायडू कहते हैं कि कुछ सुधार नहीं हो रहा है।
शत प्रतिशत जो आंध्र प्रदेश के प्रति केंद्र सरकार की जिम्मेदारी थी, हमने पूरी तरीके से निभाई है।
कंट्री पार्टनर गैबन। EBCO, simplifying lives. A modern marvel of construction and engineering.
नया रायपुर पहला इंटीग्रेटेड और देश का पहला ग्रीनफील्ड शहर है. छत्तीसगढ़ अब विकास की नई छलांग लगाने के लिए तैयार है.
नया रायपुर, birth of a smart city. At these times, only on CNBC TV18. Century Plan, sabse hai, mast rahe.
A global platform that focuses on the impact of cutting-edge technologies and innovations on our lives. Catch Mint and MIT Technology Review present MTech India 2018. At these times, only on CNBC TV18.
Because we know the real value of metal. CNBC TV18 wins the Best English News Channel Award for coverage in commodities at the 5th India International Bullion Summit. Follow the leader.
The truth is never simple, but dig for truth, we must, especially when it comes to our cities and our lives. Join me every week as I thrash out the big urban issues and all the noise surrounding real estate. From traffic nightmares to metro connectivity, from affordable homes to smart cities.
The Urban Reality with Manisha Natarajan. At these times, only on CNBC TV18.
Mangalam, aaj kya khaoge?
That's a great tagline, but with so many products, I wonder, you must be eating a lot of food, right?
I eat 5 meals a day and 2 of them are after my breakfast and lunch. Because if I like them after my meals, you will like them all the time.
Alright, on that note, I think we should sit down, catch up on your story. This is Viraj Bahal of Viba Foods.
Catch me on Weekender only on CNBC TV18.
profit from the emerging trends in the derivatives market and hedge yourself against volatile markets as we give you an update on the derivatives space. Murugappa Group presents Futures Now. Throughout the day, only on CNBC TV18.
Presented by Murugappa. Together, let's progress.
This is